Testing, 1, 2, testing, testing, testing.
Good morning, Calvary Baptist Church. Hey, it's wonderful to see so many faces. I want to take a moment to say thank you for all of you joining online. I'm sad to not see your faces. There's many faces that are missed, and I just want you to know how much we miss you, miss seeing your faces, and look forward to one day getting to. We're so thankful that you're tuning in online, and for those of you who are new tuning online, as well as to all of our guests this morning, welcome to Calvary Baptist Church. This is a church I grew up in from the third grade, and I'm still so blessed to be able to see people who were my Sunday school teachers here sitting in pews. Yes, hang your head in shame. Harry Freet. No, I'm so thankful. It's such a blessing to see people and to be a part of a body for so much of my life that has blessed me, has helped me to grow, has taught me all about Jesus and God and His Word, and has been such a blessing in my life. I love you from the Garwoods. I love my church family. So happy to be a part of worshiping the Lord still with you guys all these years, and to see so many new faces. Welcome. I want to, as well as welcome you guys together, just let you know a few things. If you have your bulletins, just want to highlight a couple things. One in particular is that we've got a Christmas Eve service, and we're very excited about it and look forward to having you join us. It's at 6 p.m. Christmas Eve. And many of you know folks who say, yeah, I'm a Christian. I go to church. Oh, yeah? When? On Easter and Christmas. And those folks, there's folks that are eager to come to church at least once or twice a year. And they might find an excuse not to, but take the opportunity to invite them, because people are eager, especially on those two occasions, whether they love the Lord or not. There's some inner obligation that they have to do something spiritual, and I would encourage you to invite them. Invite them to church where they can hear the gospel here at Calvary. A thank you. We had Christmas in October for our missionaries, and want to just be able to thank the body for your generous giving so that we were able to give $600 to each missionary family. So praise the Lord for that. Thank you so much. Our members meeting last Sunday, we were able to enjoy a great meeting to hear testimonies. I would encourage you to come show up for those just to be able to hear the testimonies of what God's doing in families in our ministry here at Calvary. It was a huge blessing. Thank you so much for sharing those testimonies, but also showing up. Let's see. We've got this is the fourth Sunday of Advent. So we're excited. You remember Advent means coming. And we're so excited about Christ's coming and His return. Today's message is going to be on the lyrics of Christmas, and specifically the song of the angels from Luke 2. I think that's it. Michael?
Worship. All right. Good morning, Calvary family. It's great to see you all. Let's stand and worship together, singing some modern and some old school Christmas songs. Let's start with Joy Has Dawned.
Joy has dawned. Today is the fourth Sunday of Advent. Advent means coming. During this season, we remember the coming of Jesus, the Son of God, into the world. And Jesus came to live the life we all should have lived. He lived a perfect life. And then he died the death we all deserved to die. He died in our place.
The first candle we lit reminded us that God's people hoped for a Savior. The second candle we lit reminded us that Jesus came to bring his peace to the world. The third candle we lit reminded us of the joy that Jesus brings to us and to all people. The fourth candle we light today represents the love of God in sending his son Jesus. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And in 1 John chapter 4, 9 through 11, it states, in this the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that God loved us and sent his son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, then we ought to love one another.
In the midst of the busyness of this Christmas season, let us remember to keep at the center of our hearts and lives the great gift of love that God has given us, his son, Jesus. God so loved us that he gave us his son to be our Lord and Savior. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for your gift of love by sending Jesus Christ to be our Savior. We want to pause and consider what a great sacrifice was made when Christ died in our place. Help us always to put you first in our hearts and lives every day, no matter how busy we are. Thank you that you loved us by sending your Son. In Jesus' name, amen. At this time, we'd like to take this moment to allow the children to be dismissed to their Sunday school classes and take a minute for every one of you to greet one another. Keep in mind safety and respect and social distancing for each other. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you. Would you join me in standing, and let's go to our God in prayer, and then we will worship in song as we prepare our hearts for the word this morning. Join me as we pray. Father, we give great thanks for the privilege, the opportunity to gather together today. As we think of our gathering in this place, indoors, in these strange times, in times in which some are vulnerable and in which our entire society is concerned about health and sickness and a mysterious virus, we continue to pray for safety for your people. We pray that you would work in our lives, keep us safe physically and also emotionally and spiritually. We pray for our troubled nation. In these days, we know that your hand as sovereign, you are at work, and yet we see so many things that are disturbing, especially if those of us who care about freedom and care about our land and a great heritage that by your grace you have given us. We pray for our nation. But we especially pray for the people of God. We pray for the Church of Jesus. We pray that in this city that you would find us faithful, that we would fulfill our mission, our role of, in this neighborhood, representing faithfully the Lord Jesus Christ and the good news that you came to save sinners, as we've just heard and reflected on. We pray that we would be faithful in that message, that we would find our authority not in what is popular, not in what is conventional wisdom, but we'll find our authority always in your revealed word, that we'll be humbled under the word, that we will be a church in which we not only love you, but we love one another well, and we love our city well. We pray for other churches in our city that have the same heart. Specifically this morning, we pray for Shoreline here in our own neighborhood. We pray for the leadership team there. We pray for the body of that church, that you would guide, strengthen them in the word and in the gospel, and prosper them. Lord, we also reflect upon our missionaries, and we pray for the Oaks as we have supported them for many, many years as they're involved with a new strategy of Bible translation into tongues and languages in which the Bible is not readily available. We thank you for their emphasis upon church-centric translation, and we pray that you would bless them as they work from Texas, as they labor with countries and languages all around the world. Now, Father, we pray for us that we might reflect your glory through this busy season. We thank you for the promise of the gospel, and we confess today our unworthiness, but we receive by faith the wonder of your forgiveness, and we find great assurance in the gospel promise, again, that we've heard already today, that here is love, not that we love you, but that you have loved us and sent your Son Jesus to be the propitiation for our sins, the setting aside of your wrath justly due our sins. And we pray that as we worship and as we come under the word this morning, and then as we go out and as we live this week in which so many people will at least have to be confronted with the idea of a baby who came as a Savior, we pray that we might be a faithful representation of that glorious good news. We pray these things not because we're worthy, but because we stand under your grace and your mercy, and you are worthy of all glory and all praise. And we pray these things as your people in this place, and all God's people said together, amen. Thank you. Remain standing and lift your voices once more as we sing.
Of glory, wing your
Please be seated. I think if we're honest this morning and we look hard at all that surrounds us, and we also listen carefully to our own hearts, we'd have to admit that the typical Christmas message brings a kind of disconnect. Yes, there's a celebration, there's a sense of goodwill. Even in this terrible year that we've been in, I hope that strangers and neighbors are a bit nicer to one another through what we call the holidays. But the truth is, there are always these echoes in the back of our minds. There's a reality of heartache. There's a reality of division. There's a reality of chaos and loss. And there's a reality of conflict. All of these issues, if we're honest about them, they cause our hearts to ache and also to ask the question, whatever happened to peace on earth? Have you ever asked that question? Whatever happened to peace on earth? I think we should acknowledge this is not a new question. Within the very narratives that we read and celebrate and we're aware of in our lives through this time of the year, we often don't think about that terrible story that we find over in Matthew 2. It's called the slaughter of the innocents. Don't turn there, but you remember that awful story where Herod is frustrated because he's heard about this newborn king of the Jews, and so his response is the response of many tyrants throughout history. In Matthew 2, verse 18, we read, Herod, when he saw that he had been tricked by the wise men, became furious, and he sent and killed all the male children in Bethlehem and in all that region that were 2 years old and under. And if you stop and think about that, you ask the question, wait a minute, what happened to peace on earth? I mean, that was what the angel said. That the issue here with the birth of a baby, it has to do with peace. The text that we're going to look at this morning, if you have your Bibles, turn there to Luke chapter 2. The text here in Luke 2, it announces what the angel says is good news. It says it's a message of great joy. And these are tidings of peace. And yet we look around us, and I think if we're honest, sometimes we look in our own hearts. Maybe sometimes we look across the dinner table on holiday gatherings, and we have to ask the question, what happened to peace on earth? Look with me in Luke 2, a very familiar text. Let's consider it this morning. Luke chapter 2, we'll pick it up in verse 8. Luke 2, verse 8, and remember, as we always remind you, this is God's word for us today. Luke chapter 2, beginning in verse 8. And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ," Messiah was the idea, "who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace. How do we resolve this tension? How do we deal with this disconnect that here in this most familiar of Bible stories, in this most familiar of angelic encounters, we find a promise that as we look around our lives and sometimes as we look into our own hearts, sometimes it's hard to see the fulfillment of that promise. You think about angels. Angels, according to the Bible, are the most spectacular of God's creation. They are creatures of overwhelming might, overwhelming splendor. You remember that every time an angel shows up in Scripture, the first words out of the angel's mouth nearly every time is, "Fear not." They are fear-producing in their appearance when God allows them to manifest themselves. And here we have what's called not a choir of angels, but it's a host of angels. And a host of angels essentially is a word which means an army. This is a multitude of the heavenly army. So it's most certainly not a choir. In scriptural terms, these are soldiers outfitted for conflict, for war. They are God's emissaries. They are God's ambassadors. And they appear, think about this, even though they are soldiers, they are announcing a message of what? Peace. And they come not to the upper crust. They don't come to the leaders, to the kings, to the influencers of society. They show up to everyday people, shepherds. They announce the peace that God is eager to bring. They announce it to people, I dare say, just like you and me. We would think that announcement would go somewhere else in our own culture. We would think it would be surely in Washington, maybe at the United Nations, I don't know, maybe Hollywood, I don't know. Surely on Twitter, and likely on Facebook and Instagram, right? But no, it comes, this message comes to everyday people, average, ordinary folks like us. But even here, even in this original event, there's a disconnect because you've got a mighty army and their announcement essentially is peace. Now, what do we do with this disconnect? What do we do with this apparent contradiction? What do we do with this tension? Here's the way a lot of people have resolved this throughout history. And I don't know, maybe you've been influenced by this kind of thinking. Several years ago, a supposed New Testament scholar, he's really a skeptic, he was interviewed in Newsweek just before Newsweek moved to only digital. And he was talking about these things, and he was dealing with this issue of the promise of the angels had to do with peace, and yet we see so little peace manifested everywhere. And so his reply as a so-called New Testament scholar was, most of all, this Jesus narrative is just a made-up feel-good story. That was his response. This is just, in a sense, wish fulfillment. This is just a novel idea that people projected their desires, they projected onto this wonderful Jesus story. I like Al Mohler's response to that scholar's skepticism. Mohler says, quote, "In the waning days of Newsweek as a print magazine, the editors decided to take on the New Testament. Readers should carefully note that it is Newsweek, not the New Testament, that has gone out of print." But even with that, the question is, how do we reconcile this angel pronouncement that brings glory and peace with the despair that's so often all around us? And maybe I can say specifically in 2020, the kind of division, the kind of, I mean, churches, I don't know if you all are aware of this. I hope you're not aware of it. So maybe I should just not say what I'm getting ready to say. Churches have divided and split over wearing masks. I mean, churches have come to such division about issues of social justice and issues of all kinds of strange issues. Churches are now dividing about vaccines and whether they're appropriate or necessary. And all of these, with all of this division, here we come together at Christmas and we remember the angels who said, "Peace on earth." What is that about? How do we reconcile this angel pronouncement with the conflict that we see so often? What do we do about this major disconnect? Well, that's what I want to share with you this morning. Because I'm not a skeptic, and I'm not in despair. I believe with every fiber of my being in this glorious promise that this angel army announced, that because of a baby born in humble circumstances 2,000 years ago, the God of glory deserves the highest praise, and he promises his peace to people who are his own. We can talk about that on at least four different levels, and I'm going to do that quickly this morning, all right? Here's the first way that in the wonder of the Christmas story, we find peace. The first way is that we find peace with God in the Christmas story. We find peace with God in this wonder of Christmas and what God was doing. The Bible says in Romans 5, verse 1, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, the issue here is this. Some of you would say, perhaps, and many who are not here this morning who heard might hear what I just said, they would say, look, I'm not at war with God. It's like the old 70s rock song, right? Jesus is just all right with me. I mean, that would be their response. The response is, hey, everything's fine. And that's all fine and good. But here's the bad news. In our sin and in our rebellion, God's at war with us. Whether we know it, whether we recognize it, whether we think it or not, the Bible says that even in the same passage, the most familiar passage in the Bible is what? John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. In that same chapter, if you read the following verses, here's what you find. Those who have not come to believe, they are already under God's condemnation. God is at war with them. In fact, that chapter ends with a terrifying verse where it says, those who have believed have received God's grace, but those who disbelieve or disobey, they are, it's, listen to this phrase, they are under the wrath of God. They are under the wrath of God. And so you may not think you're at war with God, but in your sin, God's at war with you. And you need to find the peace of God. The Old Testament says that God is angry with the wicked every day. Jesus' most well-known sermon was what we call the Sermon on the Mount. And essentially what Jesus does in that sermon is he takes the watered-down, kind of manageable message of how to make God happy, and he raises it back to, this is what it takes to please God, and he raises it back to a standard that is impossible for us to attain. This is the holiness of God. And we need to find peace with God. We need to find some way to have that all set back right. Paul in Romans defines sin as falling short of the glory of God. So here again is this disconnect. How can God's pleasure, God's favor, rest on people who are sinners like you and me? How can we find peace with God? And you know the answer, right? Nearly all of you do, surely. I'd be excited if you're here today and you don't know the answer, because I get to tell you. The answer to all of this is in what we call the gospel. It's gospel truth. It's that the God of heaven, even though we are at war with him, he reaches out. He takes the initiative. He is willing to set his favor. He is willing to reveal his good news. He is willing, it gives him pleasure to take rebels like you and me and bring us into his favor, bring us into his presence. He sends a savior. And that's right here in the text. Look with me again at the first thing that the angel says. If you'll look in verse number 10, you see what it says there? Let's walk through that carefully. In Luke 2 verse 10, it says, fear not, the angel says, for behold, I bring you good news. Now remember, the context of all of this is that God is angry with the wicked. We're at war with God because of our sin. But the angel says, no, here's good news. And it's good news what? Of a great joy. And it will be for all the people, even for people like shepherds is the idea. Not just for the leaders, not just for the Pharisees, not just for those who are priests. It'll be for all people. And of course implied, even though the text doesn't explain it, even for Gentiles. Those shepherds might not have understood that. But this is good news of a great joy for all people, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior. Why do we need a Savior? Because we're in danger. I mean, we're at a place of desperation. Unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ, that means Messiah, anointed one, and he is also the Lord. Now, we read over that quickly because we see that word so often, but the Lord was the word that was used in the Greek translation of what we call the Old Testament. It was always used for God. Remember, we read it today, and it's all in capital letters, Lord. That word that was translated into Greek is the same word, This is God himself. He is a Savior. He is Messiah. He is God himself. This is what God has done. He has found a way to bring us into peace with himself. And it's through the mystery of his Son. And so that's the first resolution of this conflict. The angels say, peace on earth. Peace to men with whom God is pleased. And that begins with the peace with God. And let me tell you what this requires. What it requires, we can find peace with God, but it requires repentant faith. It requires faith that acknowledges our need. Repentant faith. Acts chapter 20, where Paul's describing gospel ministry, the Apostle Paul said, I did not shrink from declaring to you anything that was profitable, testifying both to Jews and to Greeks of what? Of repentance toward God and of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. That's what it means to be set right with God, is you acknowledge your sin, you agree with God about your sin, you repent, you turn from your sin, and you turn to God. The greatest story of this, the greatest example of it in the New Testament, are from the words of Jesus in Luke 18, where he describes these two men praying in the temple, you remember? And one was a Pharisee who was so proud of himself, and he was thanking God he was not as other people. And what does this other person pray? This tax collector, this one that was known for his evil and for his abusing others. It says in verse 13 of Luke 18, the tax collector standing afar off would not even lift up his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Now here's what I'm asking you today. I know it's Christmas. I know you've come to Calvary Baptist. I know a lot of you are members. A lot of you are regular attenders, but I'm going to ask you specifically, what about you? Have you ever expressed repentant faith in the God who is willing to save you, but unless you do so, is angry and at war with you? Have you found peace with God? As one pastor says, have you ever truly humbly admitted that you are more sinful than you ever feared, but also realized and embraced the fact that you are more loved than you ever hoped? God is willing to enter into peace with you if you repent of your sins and trust Jesus as Savior. And that's the foundational promise of this great message that the angels sing out. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace among those with whom he is pleased. The wonder of the true Christmas message, we find that there is peace with God, which requires repentant faith. It also gives us insight into the fact that we can find the peace of God. So there's the peace with God, but there's also the peace of God. And this speaks further into this conflict, this disconnect that we've talked about. Nothing in the Christmas story demands that we deny the pervasive despair and conflict that's everywhere around us. We're surrounded by trouble. Trouble touches us, it affects us, and sometimes it infects us, doesn't it? And yet, ours is the God who promises peace. In Isaiah 26, the Old Testament prophet says, you keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you, because he trusts in you. And because we have this gospel favor, because we now know that we are at peace with God, we find peace with God through Jesus Christ, that solves the most fundamental issue of our lives, and therefore we can look at the chaos that sometimes surrounds us and the loss and the pain that sometimes we go through, and we can still have peace. We don't have to live in anxiety. It means we don't live in anxiety because our greatest issue has been solved. And the reasoning of the New Testament is that if God has solved your greatest problem, he will walk you through every other secondary problem. And therefore, we find in Philippians chapter 4, the Bible says, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. And when we do this, the idea is, verse 7, the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. You want to know the peace of God? First of all, make sure you have peace with God through repentant faith. But then you find the peace of God through what I would call resting faith. Resting faith. That you rest in Him. In 1 Peter chapter 5, we read these words, casting all your anxieties on Him. Why should you do so? Because He cares for you. He cares for you, and you can rest in that. You say, oh, but preacher, you don't understand. I think I do. You say, oh, but preacher, you don't know about my marriage. But you can cast your anxieties on Him because He cares for you. But preacher, you don't know about my financial problems, but you can cast your anxieties on Him because He cares for you. But you don't know about my secret sins. No, I don't. But you can cast your anxieties on Him because He cares for you. This is the peace of God. And it requires faith that rests in Him. And this is what believers have claimed through that terrible experience I already talked about in Matthew 2. And all the way through history, the great 16th century martyr Nicholas Ridley, on the night before he was to go to the stake and be burned by Bloody Mary, his brother came and knew that he was going to die a brutal, torturous death the next day. And so his brother said, I've come that I might spend the night here in the prison cell with you to give you peace and to try to give you comfort and encouragement. And Ridley's reply is, you don't need to stay here because I have a peace that is beyond understanding. And he said, I'm going to sleep the way I do every night. Now, I just want to, let's be real for a moment, all right? It's like the guy who says, I'm going to stop preaching and say something important, all right? So that sounds impossible to some of us, that we can know with the new dawn that we're going to be driven to a stake filled with, surrounded by kindling wood. We're going to be tied to that stake and they're going to light the kindling and we're going to stay alive while we are then burned to death. And he says, I'll sleep tonight like I slept last night because I have the peace of God. That's faith that rests. I don't know if you've ever heard the story about the five missionaries that were martyred back in the 1950s. They were killed by a tribe of Indians that they had come to try to reach, some natives in the jungles of Ecuador, and they were speared to death, all five of them, young men, men with families. And the most famous, his name is Jim Elliott. His wife was Elizabeth Elliott. And she was interviewed by Life magazine in the weeks, in the days, really, after that happened. And she said, you won't find hysteria here. Because we have a peace that is beyond understanding. Because we have a resting faith. And every objection that you can raise and every objection that I can raise, I want to promise you, has been asked and answered throughout 2,000 years of people who have rested in the faith of Jesus Christ. And all that began with a baby born in humble circumstances. And angels who said, peace on earth. Peace on people with whom God sets His favor. Glory to God in the highest. Resting faith. Listen, if our focus is not on our Savior, our Deliverer, our Lord, if it's not on Him, if our focus is on ourselves, if our focus especially is on our circumstances, we won't know the peace of God. But when we set our focus on eternal things, the Holy Spirit in some mysterious, supernatural way gives us a peace that the Bible says is beyond understanding. In the wonder of the Christmas message, we find peace with God through repentant faith, and we also find the peace of God, which I would say is resting faith. But there's more. Because through what Jesus brought, through what we call the Christmas message, through what God was doing at Christmas, we also find peace with others. We find a way to live in peace with others who surround us experientially daily. And this is not perfect. We won't know it in perfection because, in case you've forgotten, you still struggle with sinfulness just like everybody that you'll rub elbows with this week. All of us still struggle with sinfulness, but there is a pathway through which we can live even at peace with others. We can find peace with others. And this is promised in the scripture. It's commanded, in fact. In Ephesians chapter 4, we read these words, "Walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility," watch that, "and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace." This is peace with others. And if we're going to find peace with others, here's what it requires. It requires humble faith. It requires this humility. If you think about it, humility oozes out of every crevice of the Christmas story, doesn't it? The Creator and Lord of the heavens, He's announced by angels. But again, who do the angels come to? They come to shepherds, humble men. And this Creator and Lord of the universe, we sing about it in all of our songs. It's so wonderful the way poets have put this to music. And we sing it, watch for it in the lyrics later in the service, and then on Christmas Eve, it's just repeated over and over again that the majestic Lord of the universe comes in vulnerability and helplessness. He comes in humility. The King of glory is found in a manger, a feeding trough for barnyard animals. How's that for humility? And at the very least, watch this, at the very least, what this means is if we're going to find peace with others, it begins with our willingness to embrace humility. And what humility implies is we're not always going to have our own way. It's not always going to be resolved the way we want it to. We have to be willing, as another passage in the New Testament describes it, we have to be willing to think of others as more important than ourselves. That's a definition of humility. But when we are willing to do so, when we find that resource within our comfort that we have peace with God, and then we are living in the peace of God, and that means that when others cause us trouble, we can, as much as possible, the New Testament says, we can be at peace with them. Not if we always insist on our own way, not if we always insist on having the last word, but if we pursue humility to consider other people as more important than ourselves. Peace with others. I referenced this already earlier, but let me circle back to it because it's something that's very real for us. As I look out at you this morning and as I think about the folks that are watching through live stream, there are all kinds of different perspectives and opinions, for instance, about wearing masks. I know this because some of you have let me know this personally, your opinion about masks. That some of you think that masks are useless. Some of you think that masks are absolutely necessary. Some of you are like the people around here that are walking 100 yards from anybody else and they're still wearing their masks, which I don't understand. But that's not my problem because I want to consider them as more important than myself. And so I'm going to put on a mask when I have to, when I'm in their presence. We're going to put on a mask when we come and when we sing. We're already disobeying the governor and the edict of the health department by coming inside. But we're doing so because this is essential activity. But as we do so, we want to do so considering others as more important than ourselves. And so when we sing, we put a mask on. And when you're up with a person who's a close talker and you can't really strong arm them away, then you put your mask on, right? Because others, watch this, others are more important than ourselves. That's humility. This is what Jesus manifests in coming, and it's the attitude you and I have to manifest in our marriages, in our family gatherings, with our neighbors, with those who disagree with us politically. This is how we find peace with others as Jesus followers. The wonder of the true Christmas message, we find peace with God in our repentance. We find peace, the peace of God, as we rest in Him. We can find peace with others as we pursue humble faith, as we pursue humility. And then also in the wonder of Christmas, we can find peace on earth. God's not through. God's not finished. Have you ever thought about this? In the same way that When God dealt with Adam and Eve in the garden and they sinned, and remember God said, on the day that you eat of that tree, you will what? You will die. And they kept breathing. There was a sense in which they died, but there was another sense in which their death came. And in that ancient time, this is a mystery to us, that death came many, many, many years later, physical death. Well, in the same way, the angels say, and on earth peace among men with whom God is pleased. And yet we look around and we don't see this peace. We sing about it all the time, don't we? Joy to the world. He makes the nations prove the wonders of his love. Well, tell that to Iraq. Tell that to Russia or China or whoever you believe is hacking our systems, right? I mean, tell that to the bitterness that's going on in all the political system. Where is there peace on earth? Where is there true peace that we sing about? This world is still writhing in the pain of conflict. Some of us are old enough to remember when the Cold War ended, when the Berlin Wall came down. You remember that? And the Soviet Union crumbled, and we thought all of that conflict that for many of us defined our growing up years. I remember being in school, and they taught us how to duck and cover in case of a nuclear bomb. We had drills. And that's the way we lived. Christy talks about living in South Korea and living so close to the demilitarized zone and the fear that that caused because of North Korea. This is the world in which we lived. And yet we heard back in what, the 90s, that this was all over, that the Cold War was over. And no one said, oh, but watch for radical Islam. No one said that. See, the world, it just keeps cycling around again. Conflict after conflict, power grab after power grab, abuse after abuse. It is systemic in this broken world. And we cry out and we say, okay, it's true we can have peace with God. It's true we can know the peace of God. It's true that perhaps we can even have peace with one another. But where is ultimate peace on earth? How we long for this, right? And the reason we do is because this is what God, watch this, this indeed is what God has promised. You can't spiritualize all of these promises away. For example, in Isaiah 2, the Old Testament prophet says this, and many peoples shall come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of Yahweh, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways and that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go the law and the word of Yahweh from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations and shall decide disputes for many peoples, and they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. Where is that? What about Isaiah 11? The wolf shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lay down with the young goat, and the calf and the lion and the fattened calf together, and a little child shall lead them. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the cobra, and the weaned child shall put his hand on the adder's den. Where is that? They shall not hurt or destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of Yahweh as the waters cover the sea. Where is that? And I'm going to just suggest to you, to challenge your eschatology, you just can't spiritualize all of those truths. These are promises that God made to his people Israel, and one day he's going to fulfill this promise. There will be on earth this kind of peace. And this is future faith. This is future faith. And we can cling to it, and we can hold to it, and we can believe it, and we can long for it. And don't misunderstand, we can even work for it. It's appropriate for governments, for those who represent us, to strive for this kind of peace. But we know that ultimately, it will not ultimately come until Jesus, the Prince of Peace, rules from his throne. And this is God's end game. This is what God will do. He will bring peace on earth. And for that we wait with future faith. Peace with God in repentance. The peace of God, resting. Peace with others, that requires humility. And one day there will indeed be peace on earth. And we look for that in the future. Now there's an issue here that I haven't addressed, but let me bring it up as I work toward a conclusion. Most of us were raised with this quotation of the angel's message. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. It's the King James. And you'll notice that in nearly all of our modern versions, it doesn't say goodwill toward men, as though it's a universal generic promise. It says, as our text does, the ESV, it says in verse 14, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased. Now that's a fairly radical difference. And you all will thank me for not going into all of the Greek reasons that there is a difference in translation. But I will tell you that all of the difference rests on one little letter that's in some manuscripts and that's absent in other manuscripts. And the ones in which the manuscripts has it absent, those read goodwill toward men, as though it's a generic promise that just all men will receive goodwill, peace on earth, goodwill toward men. But that letter in the Greek grammar, if it is there, if it was original in what the angel said, then what the angel said was glory to God in the highest and on earth peace among men with whom or to whom God gives his favor. Just one little letter makes a difference. And there are different opinions about which is the accurate translation. But I'm going to suggest this to you this morning, again, without going into all of the details. If you look at the way the Old Testament uses that Greek word, the Greek translation of the Old Testament uses that same word, and if you also look at the language of the Jews during their time, this idea of those upon whom God sets his favor was a very, very common perception. It's that the God of heaven, not because of anything inherent within us, but because of his love, the God of heaven takes initiative and sets his favor on those he chooses to bless. You have it in what we call the Old Testament. You have it in, for example, the life of Adam. You have it in the life of Enoch. You have it in the life of Noah. You have it in the life of Abraham. You have it in the life of Moses. And indeed, these Old Testament men and women, they lived a life in many ways that were favorable to God. But the burden of the text is that the reason they did so is because God took initiative with them. That God's favor rests upon them. So I'm going to suggest to you, according to the translations that we typically use, I think they're accurate. This is not some generic announcement, the way that the older Christmas carols make it sound, but this is a specific promise. Listen carefully. The promise of peace on earth omits those who are indifferent to God's standard of peace. The promise of peace on earth omits those who are too proud to humble themselves. The promise of peace that God gives here, it's a promise that's not for those who are too proud, who are too busy, who find themselves too sophisticated. Fine, that's where they are. They have no claim on God's message of peace. But you know who it is for? It's for all those, stop, listen. It's for all those who fall short of the glory of God. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to those with whom God is pleased, or with those whom God finds favor, or with those who God sets his favor. Those are the ones who, though they are sinners and fall short of the glory of God, they've acknowledged it. They repent of it. They turn from it. And they do so because of God's kind initiation. It's not just some generic promise. It's for all who have recognized that they fall short of the glory of God. And so this is glory to God in the highest, because what God does, here it is, what God does is he loves and he seeks and he redeems and he adopts and he brings peace to rebels like us. That's God's glory. That's the reason angels are saying this. Think about it. The angels have been waiting since the dawn of creation. The angels know what God said to the serpent when he deceived our first parents. The angels have been waiting for this day to come, and they have watched. They have watched with people like Abraham. God set his favor on him, and the angels saw all the rotten things that Abraham did, and they were astonished, and yet they were waiting. And they were waiting as God worked with the people of Israel. And they were waiting as God worked through Moses. And they were waiting as we're studying the book of Judges, as God continued to love his people Israel in spite of their disobedience. And it's as though the angels were looking at one another and saying, when will all this be set right? And then they recognize that the King of Glory comes as a baby born in a manger. And they say, glory to God in the highest. Because now God is bringing his peace to people upon whom he set his favor. And that's the reason the Bible says the chastisement of peace like for rebels like us, it was upon him, the Savior. It's the reason the Bible says that he made peace with rebels like us through the blood of his cross. We talk about the slaughter of the innocents. We read about it earlier. Experience this peace. It all circles back to the slaughter of the innocent. The one who was innocent. This is God's glory. In this way, the one who is just becomes a justifier of those who are unworthy, of those who are rebels. And watch this, and with this I'm through. This is the whole point of God's great rescue plan. There's no question that God loves me and loves you, but we're not the main issue. The main issue is God's glory. And as the God of the universe, in all of his righteousness and absolute holiness, as he reaches down and he takes someone that is as self-willed and as selfish and as sometimes bitter and sometimes carnal as someone like me, and he makes a rebel like me his own child, the result of that is the greater glory of God. And that's the reason the angels are saying, glory to God in the highest. Because look at what God is doing. He's bringing peace to people who don't deserve it. This is God's glory. We are rescued for his glory. And I just want to ask you, when's the last time that stunned you? When's the last time you thought about the God of the universe? I know you're dealing with all kinds of stuff. I know there are all kinds of problems, but let me just ask you, in all of the complexity of your life, when was the last time you stopped and were just, and it almost took your breath away, that the God of heaven loves you and sent his son to be your savior? Glory to God in the highest. And on earth, peace to those upon whom his favor rests. In all the conflict and trouble, and all of this chaos that we're living in, this is peace, and this is glory. So why don't we live it out this week, and why don't we share it to God's glory? Father, thank you for the wonder of the good news of the gospel. Thank you that you save sinners. Thank you that we can find peace with you, for you are justly angry with all of our disobedience. And yet through Jesus, we find the peace that you offer with yourself. We can find the peace that you offer in our hearts, in our conflicts. We can find peace with others through humility. And we believe one day you will manifest this glorious peace in all the earth. Help us not forget these cosmic, eternal issues in the busyness of this week. May we reflect upon these things. May we rejoice in them. May they infect our countenance. May they affect the way we treat others. May they infuse our family gatherings. Give us a sense of joy, a sense of wonder. Give us a sense of great hope because of that message the angel army brought 2,000 years ago. And we will thank you for all these things. In Jesus' glorious name, amen. Would you stand and let's respond in worship. The only way it makes sense to sing that song, I mean, you read the newspaper, we don't have newspapers much anymore, right? But I mean, you see the news. This is not happening yet, but we sing it in future faith, believing that God's not spoken the last word. And for us, we live in repentant faith and in resting faith and hopefully in humble faith with one another. And in future faith. And with that as a good word, have a great week. We'll see you on Christmas Eve. Come back and invite guests. We'll worship with masks. We'll be together. We'll sing. It'll be a great service at 6 o'clock on Christmas Eve. There's coffee over in Sizer Hall. We'd love to meet you. So join us over there. God bless you. Have a great week. You're dismissed.